The first hypothesis test that we will learn allows us to compare the mean of a sample to the mean from a population. We do this using a one-sample t-test in JASP. The one-sample t-test is a parametric procedure, meaning that we will assume that what we learn from our sample is also true of the population from which our sample was drawn. When we have a sample of scores, the one-sample t-test tests whether our sample mean is statistically significantly different than a population mean or another known value. Previously, we imagined a population of polar bears that walk an average of 100 miles per week. As is usually the case, we did not know the standard deviation of the population, or sigma. Usually, this occurs because we have not actually measured the entire population. When we want to compare a sample to this known population value, for example, a sample of polar bears who consumed caffeine and walked an average of 150 miles per week with a standard deviation of 9, we use the one-sample t-test to help us make a fair comparison between the sample and its population. For this hypothetical example, we have read a journal article in Martha Stewart Correctional Quarterly reporting that the average national score for women on a test of indoor gardening is 73, but there is no standard deviation reported. We want to know how men will score on this same test. We randomly select 9 men, and we compare their sample mean of 66.56 to the population mean for women, which we have already established is 73. We start with a null hypothesis that our sample of men has been pulled from a population of men who have the same mean as the women. Again, 73. We assume that there is no difference between men and women on this test. We write that null hypothesis as H0:μ=73. Now, this is the same example as when we calculated a t-test by hand in class. In Excel, I have opened the data from the MarthaStewart.csv dataset that we are going to import. We can see that the variable name is men, and that we have 9 scores, one for each of the 9 men who participated in this test. If you do not have this dataset, stop the video now and enter the data that you see here. Save the data file to your desktop. Once you have JASP open on your computer, we will open the data by going to our main menu icon, Open, Computer, Desktop. Locate the MarthaStewart.csv dataset and click Open. JASP will read the file and show you the data. We can see that JASP thinks that our data are ordinal, but we intend for them to be scale data because they are measuring the number of correct responses. We want to change the column type. Note that if you click on the name of the variable, you will be able to change the label, not what we want to do with this variable. Instead, click on the icon next to the variable name to change the column type. Now we are ready to do our one sample t-test in JASP. But first, let's walk through the 5 steps of hypothesis testing so that we know what we are doing with this test. Step 1, select the appropriate statistic. The appropriate statistic for comparing a sample mean to a known population value when the population standard deviation is unknown is the one sample t-test. Step 2, state the null and alternative hypothesis. We want to know if the mean for men is different than the known mean for women. So this is a non-directional or two-tailed test. The null and the alternative hypotheses are going to be exactly the same as when we did this test by hand. The null hypothesis is H0:μ=73. This means that the sample of men is drawn from a population whose mean is 73. The alternative hypothesis is H sub 1 colon mu does not equal 73. Step 3, select a level of significance. For selecting our level of significance, we will be using a two-tailed test because we are not establishing a direction that the dependent variable will change. For most research, the level of significance will be alpha equals 0.05. Now, technically, you could set that alpha level to any value that your heart desired. But for scientific research, you really only have two choices, alpha of 0.05 and alpha of 0.01. Unless the problem says otherwise, assume that the value is alpha 0.05, two-tailed test. The degrees of freedom always equals n minus 1, where n is the number of participants in your sample. In this case, with 9 men, we have 8 degrees of freedom. So to find the critical value, we go to students' t-distribution table. We are using a two-tailed test, so we will focus on the columns on the left. The alpha level is 0.05 with 8 degrees of freedom, so our critical value is positive negative 2.306. Alternatively, you can download the Research by Design effect size calculator for t-tests and use it to determine your critical value. Here you see the 6 things that you can do with this effect size calculator. Click on the green tab for critical values. In the upper left, we have the setup for a typical alpha equals 0.05 two-tailed test. Simply enter your degrees of freedom. Click or hit return, and your critical value, 2.306, appears right here. But wait, there's more. If you are not doing the typical two-tailed alpha of 0.05 test, enter your degrees of freedom here, click, and you get critical values for both one and two-tailed tests at a variety of common alpha levels. You can also customize the settings in this original box. So any t-values exceeding 2.306 indicate that the mean of the sample of men is statistically significantly different than the population value for women. Step 4, calculate the statistics. For this, let's go back to JASP. We conduct a one-sample t-test on these data by clicking on T-Tests, One-Sample T-Test. In the results pane, we already see the table where the t-test results are going to appear. The only variable that we have is men. Move men into the variables pane. Because JASP uses dynamic updating, we already see the results of our t-test in the results pane. However, these results are not correct because there is something very important that we have to do first. We must tell JASP what is our comparison test value. By default, JASP compares our sample mean to a population mean of 0. We see that in this box labeled test value. In our study, however, we established that the comparison mean, the mean for women, is 73. I say that this is very important because if you do not enter a number for the test value, then the comparison value will be 0. And if you use a comparison value of 0 when you should be comparing to 73, you will get the wrong answer. Enter 73 into the test value. Now think about your null hypothesis. We are saying that this sample of men is drawn from a population that, like women, has a mean of 73. Let's examine some of the other settings. We have some options for our alternative hypothesis. We are doing a two-tailed test, which means that our alternative hypothesis is that the sample mean is different than our comparison test value of 73, or that it is not equal to 73. But we could do a one-tailed test to determine if our sample mean is significantly higher than or lower than a given test value. Another important thing to do is to test the assumptions of our data. In this case, the assumption of normality. When we click this option, we get a Shapiro-Wilk test, and I'll explain this in a moment. Under Additional Statistics, select Location Parameter, and with it, the Confidence Interval. Select the effect size and the descriptive statistics. We can also get a plot of the descriptive statistics here. Let's look at our results more closely. In the results pane, we should begin by checking the assumption of normality with our Shapiro-Wilk test. We will discuss assumptions more deeply in a future lecture, but for now, know that we prefer that our assumption check tests be non-significant. Think of it like this. The test assumes that our data are a certain way. When an assumptions test is non-significant, it means that our data are not significantly different than the test assumes that they are. This is what we want. We prefer non-significant assumptions tests. The p-value of 0.60 for this normality check, which is not anywhere close to being less than 0.05, tells us that the men's scores are not significantly different in their normality than the t-test assumes that they are. Basically, the men's scores are close to being normally distributed, therefore the assumption is not violated. Good news. But what would we do if this test showed a significant difference if the assumption of normality was violated? We would go back to our settings, and we would choose Wilcoxon's signed rank test, which tests against the population median score rather than the mean. And we would uncheck students' t-test. Now this would, of course, require knowing the median value of the women's scores in order to do it right. Now that our test assumptions have been met, we can interpret the t-test itself. We see a box labeled descriptives. In this box, we see the sample size, the mean, and the standard deviation, and the standard error of the mean. We will use all of these later for our APA-style write-up. The results for the t-test itself are in the box labeled One Sample T-Test. The t-test value is -3.232. In this case, the negative value for t means that our sample mean is less than our comparison value of 73. You interpret a positive t-value and a negative t-value in exactly the same way. The sign for the t-test only indicates whether your sample mean was larger or smaller than the comparison value. In the APA-style write-up, you could ignore this negative sign if you want. The t of -3.232 exceeds or is larger than the critical value of positive or negative 2.306. Degrees of freedom is 8. We can also see that this significance value for the test is 0.012, which is less than 0.05. We also see that the 95% confidence interval for the difference between sample means, which is mean 1 minus mean 2, shows a lower bound of -11.04 and an upper bound of -1.847. Because this confidence interval does not cross 0, it does not include the null hypothesis value of 0 difference. Then the groups are different. All three of these findings tell us exactly the same thing. There is a statistically significant difference between these two means. We see this same result with our descriptives plot. Our comparison value is 73. That is the dotted line. Our mean is the dot, and our confidence interval is the bar. Notice how no part of the confidence interval crosses the dotted line. This is a useful confirmation, but I would not actually include this plot in my write-up. The last thing that we need is Cohen's D effect size for our one sample t-test. The effect size is a -1.08. We interpret a negative effect size exactly the same way that we interpret a positive effect size. The negative sign just tells us that the sample mean was lower than the population mean. If the sample mean was larger than the population mean, this effect size would have been a +1.08. Regardless, the actual effect was still the same size. So let's go back to our five steps of hypothesis testing. Step 4, calculate the statistics. The t-test value is negative 3.232. We will round that to negative 3.23. The critical value was positive or negative 2.306. The obtained t-value exceeds the critical value. This means that the t-test is significant, and the sample mean differs statistically significantly from the population mean. We reject the null hypothesis that says there is no difference between the sample and the population. Finally, step 5, make the decision. Men, with their mean and standard deviation, scored significantly lower than women, with their mean, we do not have a standard deviation for the population, on a test of indoor gardening, and then the write-up for the t-test. T with 8 degrees of freedom equals negative 3.23, probability equals 0.012. And here is how we would write up these results in APA style. Notice that the T, the P, and Cohen's D are all italicized, and the degrees of freedom, 8, is in parentheses. I changed the color of the p-value to stress the difference between the write-up by hand that used p less than 0.05 and this write-up for JASP, which reports the actual probability. The last statement about gender difference would go in your discussion section if you're writing this up for a paper.